and I think in Croke Park is the one place you don't want to be chasing the game because it leaves gaps. So I would say Glen will be playing with the breeze into the Hill 16 end in the first half, and I think it'll be down to Bridges to try and limit the amount of scores they can get in that period.
They certainly were, as the midfield pairing of Conor Glass and Emmett Bradley join Eddie Nolan and Shane Cunanan in the middle of the park. Brendan Colley gets the 2024 All-Ireland Senior Club Football Championship final underway. It's St. Bridget's wearing their change strip of all-black in possession of the football, playing towards the Davin stand area of Croke Park. They will play against whatever breeze is available. Croke Park can be like its own microclimate on the best of days. The men from Mahara, wearing green and yellow, will shoot in this first half down towards Hill 16 and will have the advantage of that breeze. Conlith, a man like me who's never played in Croke Park, only hears about this microclimate that Croke Park is. How different is it down there with these big towering stands?
Yeah, massively different. Like, if you're in the corner of the Davin, the wind is with you regardless of what way it's blowing, whereas if you're kicking into the hill, the wind's always swirling around. But just interesting straight away, the switches, the matchups. Michael Warnock has picked up Ben O'Carroll, Ryan Dugan has picked up Brian Dervin, as we thought, and Conor Carvel and Bobby Nugent. So other than that, Conor Glass is sweeping at the top of the D, but it's man for man everywhere else.
Ben O'Carroll sending the football out on that left-hand side, takes it on the return, trying to make something happen for St. Bridget. That first attempt at a hand-a-toe wasn't exactly perfect. He's almost bundled up. He's done well to get it away there towards Paul McGrath, the joint captain, sent towards the fullback Brian Stack. Worked well here from St. Bridget's in the hands of Robbie Dolan. He's crowded out though, and great tackles coming in there from Alex Doherty. Forced back out in their first pursuit of a score, St. Bridget's. The opportunity looked to be on for a few of them, none of them fancying it in these early exchanges. And Conlon, St. Bridget's, we talked about this fast start that they got against Corrifin and they got against Castlehaven in the semi-final. They seem to be a tough team to reel in if they can't get that good start.
Yeah, they have, and if there's nerves is a problem for St. Bridget's. They're not showing it because they've been very good on the ball, and O'Carroll with his right foot
comes off the
post.
Big post and falls into the hands of Eunan Mulholland. So the first attempt, the first strike at goal from Ben O'Carroll, striking the big post, falling into the waiting hands of Eunan Mulholland. It could have been dangerous because a St. Bridget's man was lurking. Jody McDermott in possession of the football on his own 65, carrying it into the St. Bridget's half of the field now in front of the Cusick stand, working it well towards Ryan Dugan, sent inside towards Conor Glass. Liam Haird, and he's got the orange boots, does well to work it back out. Left footed effort does come in, and it's the first shot on goal from a Glen perspective, and it has also went and tailed to the left and wide. Cahill Mulholland. So early shots on goal for both sides, Conlith, and no such success.
Yeah, no, but it was interesting whenever Conor Glass went to full forward, it obviously showed that he had a real advantage in speed on Shane Cunanan. So that may be something to employ, but that was a really good chance and they cut them open very easily.
First opportunity for Cormac Sheehy to get a touch of the ball, and his kick out flies over the head of a few. The breaking ball though is going to be won by Conor Carvel. Work back across to Ethan Doherty. Enjoyed a few big days here over the last couple of years. Of course, he's the Young Footballer of the Year at the All-Star ceremony before Christmas. He did not attend that ceremony though. It's a stray hand pass early doors from Paul.
And Ryan Dugan's hamstring wouldn't have appreciated that, having to reach out at that there, but look, he broke out quick and it looks like he's very much okay.
Yeah, he's happy to get himself forward in the early exchanges. Ryan Dugan, a huge boost for Malachy O'Rourke to have him available today. Here's Robbie Dolan crossing the 45, his options to his left hand side, and opts to use it. St. Bridget's happy enough just to keep possession in this early exchange. 3.5 minutes played on BBC Radio Foyle, also available wherever you are in the world through BBC Sounds. This is the All-Ireland Senior Football Club Championship final. St. Bridget's of Roscommon taking on Watty Graham's Glen of Derry. Ben O'Carroll, the Roscommon star, the main man in this St. Bridget's attacking outfit. He was pulled. Brendan Colley bringing it back for that advantage. And Conlith, in the early exchanges, it's a young and it's an inexperienced St. Bridget's team to a point, but they look comfortable on the big stage so far.
Yeah, look, as I say, the nerves hasn't been a factor, and that was a Brian Stack has come forward. And if you're looking for the most experienced man on the team and a man that has already won an All-Ireland club medal, Brian Stack's the man they needed, and that's a real settling score for St. Bridget's.
Brian Stack getting himself forward. 4.5 minutes gone, he's opened the scoring, wearing three on his back, but didn't look like a full back strike in that one. He's put the Roscommon men into an early lead.
Yeah, and early on, Ben O'Carroll looks like he's had the run of the park. Warnock has struggled with him. He's got ball. But again, Shane Walsh started the semi-final like that, and Warnock eventually got clumpers on him.
Here comes Conleth McGuckian, carrying it forward out on the left. We'll look for options inside as well. Marshalled by Alan Daly. Good effort, though, from the boot of Kieran McFall. The umpires are going to have a look about it. Do they like it? No, they don't. It's wide for McFall to the left and wide, so doubles the Glen wide count in these early exchanges. I'm not going to call it early. Would it be early nerves for a man like Kieran McFall, who's played in big games in Croke Park last year, but I suppose it's his first All-Ireland club final?
Yeah, it is, but again, the breeze in that corner is nearly against you as well, but that's not the side he normally kicks from. He likes kicking across himself, but the amount of room he got would be a worry from a St. Prince's point of view. When you look up now, they're playing man-to-man at the back, so they're really pressing on it.
They certainly are, as Ethan Doherty comes inside, so familiar, so good on it. He's picked up a couple of scores for Derry this way, under the challenge of two St. Bridget's men. Nope, knocks it back as far as Ryan Dugan. Ryan Dugan wearing three on his own 45, able to find Conor Glass. Glass happy just to take it on the spot, take a bounce, take a solo, and work it towards Emmett Bradley, his midfield partner. 14 of the St. Bridget's 15 in retreat in defensive positions. Here's the Mara captain, Conor Carvin. Conleth McGuckian comes inside from the left touchline, strikes it from the 21. This one, though, to the left and wide also. So we've played just 6 minutes of this All-Ireland final, and the Glen wide count reads as three. And Conleth, just if we look at them flags from Hill 16, they're almost blowing to the right. They're blowing about everywhere, so that wind could be very tricky to kick into.
Again,
as you
very
said.
Difficult, especially from this side at the Hogan Stand, because the breeze not only is against you, but if they're kicking from the other side, they have a better chance. But it's the ease in which they've got the shots away, which would be worrying from a rigid point of view and very pleasing for Molly Gilwork.
Yeah, Conleth McGuckian definitely got away there pretty easy as St. Bridget's carry the ball into the Glen half of the field. The man on it is Connor Hand. Hand worked inside to the centre forward, Kieran Sugru. Does well to get it back as far as Owen Hand, and it's opened up for him. Conor Glass there with a vital interception. The big long right arm of Glass, and more importantly, the right hand to dispossess and knock it from the hands of Owen Hand.
Yeah, and Conor Glass looked, and it was Robbie Dolan came in. Had Conor Glass not got a hand, and Robbie Dolan was bearing down on goal 1-1. That's what Glass brings. You know, it's not only his leadership qualities in the middle, but defensively he just makes it so sound.
Yeah, he's almost like the sweeper version for Derry and for Glen, and in the modern game, and especially if things are starting to open up, you need a man who can see a couple of plays ahead, and that's certainly what Glass was all about there.
Yeah, and the beauty is like Eddie Nolan and Conan, for good midfielders, they're not big scorers, so they're not going to score from range, so he can drop off a wee bit.
And here's Ethan Doherty taking on Rory Fallon, slipped as far as Mulholland. Cal Mulholland goes down under the challenge. Brendan Colley, match referee, says it's a free, so straight in front of the post, 21 yards from goal. It should be a nice one for Glen to start, and it's going to be the left-footed Emmett Bradley who's going to go across and take it. Conleth, Emmett Bradley opted away from the Derry panel this year, and arguably the best year of club football that I've certainly seen him play.
Yeah, look, he opted off and obviously got married, and he went in honeymoon for a prolonged period, and probably that freshness coming back into a really good club side at the top end of it probably helped him, and I would suspect he will go back and throw his lot into Derry. But early on in this game, it is Ethan Doherty that has caused all the trouble. He was very unlucky that last time. Yeah, he got the ball, you know, and he slipped it through to Mulholland, but it's him that's causing the trouble, and he's the one player that looks like St. Bridges haven't got a grip on yet.
So Emmett Bradley, after 9 minutes, gets the Ulster champions up and running. Nice sider for a free taker. That's a fine take there from Shane Conan. Out in the middle of the park, receiving that from Cormac Sheehy. Wastes no time getting play up and running. Here's the full forward, Brian Derwin, looks for options inside, and he doesn't just spot out that left hand side. The run of, can't exactly see who it was at this stage, but he was adjudged to have been fouled by Conleth McGuckie, and I think that man burying through the middle was Ronan Stack, and Eunan Mulholland maybe just lost the run of him for a second.
But yeah, and I think probably fortune, it was in the softer side of a free kick. McGuckie actually done very well, he knocked the ball away, but this is one where O'Carroll has got the range, but it's into a stiff breeze, and even in the hurling from this sort of range, it proved to be difficult.
Yeah, maybe just 10 yards inside the 45, it'll be a few more, almost out on the touchline, but by the time O'Carroll steals a few steps, he hasn't struck that one well at all. It's going to drop in between the 14 and the 21. Conor Glass goes across. Conor Glass wins that duel with Shane Conan, and Glenn set about another attack. Ryan Dugan gives it back to Glass. Glass takes a few solos, looks back to his left-hand side, finds Kieran McFall. McFall switches the emphasis of the attack from the centre out to this left-hand side in front of the Hogan stand. Bearing inside the 45 is Ethan Doherty. Connell said he's caused all the problems so far, Glenn, and he certainly has done that. Once again, it's Kieran McFall. Jinx back, thought about the shot. The edge of the D with Ethan Doherty. Steps inside very easily. Looks to have been fouled there, Ethan Doherty. Brendan Colley says no. Back as far as Emmett Bradley on the left foot. He's got one from a free. He's got one from play. And Glen lead for the first time in this contest. 10 minutes played. Glen 2, St. Bridget 1.
Yeah, and it's no more than Glen have deserved. When you look from this vantage point looking out, Glen make the pitch look so big. They have two men inside the 45 on either side. They've only one man at the edge of the D, and that's to create space for the big runners like Ethan Doherty. And it was Emmett Bradley who caught a great catch that's caused a lot of trouble as well.
And it's Emmett Bradley who has just won that restart out there from Cormac Sheehy. Glen looking comfortable. Must have been something said to Brendan Colley along the way, because it's brought it forward a couple of yards. And whatever yards it was brought forward, Emmett Bradley goes back just to recycle possession with Ryan Dugan. Kieran McFall out on this right hand side now with Ethan Doherty. Steps inside so quick at that little jink, just absolutely walks past Rory Fallon into the hands of Danny Tallon. McGuckian, Conleth McGuckian with it once again. Comes through a serious body of work for this South Derry side. Conor Glass just so calm and composed. Don't have to panic, Glenn. Looking for the pockets of space when they find him. Ops not to take his mark there. Does Eunan Mulholland. Finds Conleth McGuckian. McGuckian back again with Mulholland. Mulholland just ran under his legs. He lost it for a second, and it's St. Bridget's who will come out with possession of the football. Eddie Nolan, but that was, I think it's a hospital ball it's called, but he's done well to get away. Glenn pressing up high, happy to take the game to St. Bridget's up there. Stiff challenge from Cahill Mulholland, and St. Bridget's are forced back. They don't have the options, and Conleth, that's quite a high press from Glenn, even though they were overturned on their own 14.
Yeah, and if you look at the score they got against Kilmacud that looked like it was going to win it, they stayed high for the kick out. So they have been very, very brave in games, and they're not there now as well, and they have the physical advantage. They look a wee bit sort of more physical in that area.
And here comes Shane Cunnan, looks to knock it inside. It was almost like the pass that dismantled Kilmacud Crokes. It's a shot there from Robbie Dolan, and it's very, very well blocked from Tiernan Flanagan. He looked to take Flanagan on, ran out of options. The point is probably a good score at this early juncture, Conn.
Yeah, and look, if you get one-on-one around the 20-metre line in Croke Park and you make bad options like that there, you can't really blame anybody else. If that happened in the Glen side, we'd be looking at a goal now, and that's probably the big difference. That was poor from Dolan.
Conor Glass, the Derry captain, has it right in centre field, gives it off to his county teammate, Kieran McFall. Been a huge boost to have him back for Derry and their run to the All-Ireland semi-final this year, and also for Glen in their pursuit of an elusive All-Ireland senior club title. Happy just Glen. They look the more complete team, Conleth.
Look, this looks so comfortable. You look at Ethan Doherty out there, and Rory Fallon obviously is afraid of space. He's starting 5 yards away, but that's given Ethan Doherty 5 yards. He doesn't need 5 yards. Two steps and he's gone. And I think that's the one area where St. Bridget are probably going to be looking to change sometime soon.
Emmett Bradley thought about the shot on the left foot right away towards the right of the D. Tiernan Flanagan, that's a really, really poor ball from Tiernan Flanagan, and there's a break on here for St. Bridget's, and he's going to continue his run. Condon Bradley was a long way from goal. Here comes St. Bridget's, real opportunity. This lovely break as far as Ben O'Carroll. What a save! An absolutely incredible save from Conlon Bradley, bearing down a goal there was Ben O'Carroll. The run was from Rory Fallon. If he puts it either side of Conlon Bradley, he probably scores, but he put it down his throat, and I suppose Bradley just stood and let it hit him.
Yeah, he did, but Michael Warnock done really well. He didn't overcommit too early, and he made them make a really difficult choice. And look, it was a case that he'd run so far. I thought Brian Stack had done brilliant there, but again, all Conlon Bradley had to do is stand big. Yep, they got the run of luck, but that free is just probably, at least it's something for Tiernan Flanagan, especially being the last man. A crossfield ball like that was so dangerous.
Yes, Ben O'Carroll does put the resulting 14-yard free between the sticks and levels us up for a second time, but it was such a, when we see the replay there, Conor, it was such a poor strike.
Yeah, it was, and if it had been any other player, you know, obviously Brian Stack isn't the paciest player in the team, so it took him a wee while to get up there, and it just allowed Conlon Bradley, who was actually at the 65 metre line when the ball broke, so it wasn't even one on one, it was less than that.
It certainly was, and it's St. Bridget's who have won Conlon Bradley's restart. Robbie Dolan, and here comes St. Bridget's once again. They work it back inside. Conor Glass comes across and gets a good hand in there. The rest of it is picked up, and Glen have possession of the football. Glass happy just to work it back out the right hand side towards Ryan Dugan. They're in no panic to get forward. As the Glass sends it over the top of Michael Warnock, the wind's going to catch that one, and it's going to go out for a sideline ball. That's twice that it's been poor passes the outside of the right boot from Dugan, and he just sent it over the top of Michael Warnock's head. So slack in possession at times, the Ulster champions.
Yeah, and it's very un-Glen-like, because the one thing you associate with Glen is control and precision and not giving the ball away. And look, maybe nerves, it's maybe the wind, it's maybe conditions, but it's just not something you associate with them. And it's a case that just allows Brigid to live in the game, and the longer in the game as underdogs, the more they'll believe. And for kicking the ball away, it's moved into a 30-35 metre free kick at the angle.
Yeah, so just as that ball went over the head of Michael Warnock, he did continue on, and he did boot the O'Neill size 5 into the Hogan stand. He can't do that, and Brendan Colley happy enough to penalise it, so it suits the left booter. It suits Ben O'Carroll. He's already got one from a free today. This one's struck a lot better on his left boot. Missed up the goal chance. Hits the top of the netting just to make sure the umpires are under no illusions that it did go between the sticks. And once again, St. Brigid lead 3-2.
Yeah, and when it was in the air, it looked like it was going over comfortably, and the wind just held it up. So it just shows how difficult the breeze is there. And Glen, even uncharacteristically, like with a pass there, hitting it over Dugan's head. Normally, the one thing you'd associate with Glen is they always win their own kickouts, and they always make the opposition go long. And they've done half of that. But it's interesting that the big push from St. Brigid's, and they've done really well from kickouts.
They certainly have. And Conlon Bradley took the kick out and went and took it back once again. So all 15 of the Glen players outside of their own 65. He did kick a point in the Derry Senior Club final, did Conlon Bradley. Happy to get it forward against Maher Felt, another team who played a fairly defensive formation. Here comes Michael Warnock, kicked a point off Mannion in that semi-final. Ops though to give it to one of the shooters. Danny Tallon shirks a couple of challenges. Ryan Dugan thought about the shot the first time. Ryan Dugan does think about the shot the second time. It's wild though when it's going to go harmlessly to the left and wide out over that sideline. It's just uncharacteristic mistakes we're not used to see Glen make, Colin.
No, you're not. And again, it's probably Dugan, while he's a great footballer, he's probably not known for scoring from 40 metres, and those are the things that you don't associate Glen with.
It's four wides already for Glen. I'm sure that's something that Molly O'Rourke will be addressing at half time. But here come Roscommon champions, St. Brigid's, once again, as Ben O'Carroll gets away from a number of challenges. Looked like he was going to run out of steam. Thankfully for him, though, he had Bobby Nugent. Bobby Nugent pops it on the left foot on the loop. It's good from Nugent. Double scores. It's St. Brigid's 4. That's Glen 2. And I'll tell you what, Con, they're talking about the counter-attacking ability of St. Brigid's. They're certainly showing it here through the first 18 minutes.
Yeah, but it was Cormac Sheehy's ability to get over the first press and find the free man, which was really impressive. But I think, as Desi touched on at the start, who do you mark? Who's a dangerous player? But at the minute, Ben O'Carroll is the star turn.
He certainly is. And straight away, though, Glen, he couldn't gather it at the first opportunity, could Conor Glass, but he has it on the 21. He's looking to take on Shane Cunanan. He looks to have the physical attributes to beat him. He does. Glass. Glass gets it on the left foot. Glass dispatches it between the posts. Leadership qualities from the big player. Clutch plays in the big day. And I suppose that's just pure class from Conor Glass, and they're going to need more from him.
Yeah, it is, and he's had a really good game. He's had two very, very good interventions. He set up the first shooting chance, and now he scored one himself. Conor probably has got a lot of unfair criticism about his performances in Croke Park, but the one thing he's showed today, that he's going to lead from the front, and he's been excellent so far.
St. Brigid's have it once again. It's Ben O'Carroll who looked to take on Michael Warnock. Does get inside him. He's given him a torrid time so far. Ran out of options though, and was able to find Kieran Sugrue. Sugrue took it on the spin, shirked off the challenge, right footed between the sticks. And St. Brigid's certainly showing in this first quarter that they are more than up for the match, defying what many bookmakers said would be an easy contest for Glen. They lead here after 19 minutes on BBC Radio Foyl and on BBC Sounds, 5-3. And this is a proper final. We should know by now that club contests, I suppose these unfamiliar matchups, Conlon, it's never all that easy.
Yeah, look, because last year you kind of knew that, you know, Michael Warnock could mark Walsh, you know, but he's never marked Ben O'Carroll in his life, and you think it's going to be the right matchup, but so far he hasn't been able to lay a glove on him.
The kick out from Conlon Bradley. They're going to battle for it. Something resembling a scrum down there. Eventually it falls into the hands of Connor Glass, who's going to leave it in long for Alex Doherty, but he's left it in high, and they're going to battle for it, and it's very, very well done. That's incredible defending from Pierce Frost. A shake of the head there from Johnny McBride. I don't think he's all too happy about that long ball in there, a wastage of possession. But it's Paul McGrath, the joint captain for St. Bridget, who carries it forward. A slip though from Connor Hand, which gives the opportunity for Kieran McFaul to go in. He was slapping with both hands over zealous in his approach to the tackle, said Brendan Colley. So it'll be a free just outside of the 45 for the men from Roscommon. The man standing over it is Connor Hand.
Yeah, and the one thing about Brendan Colley is that he's refereed the game very technically. Like, he hasn't allowed any over-aggressive tackles, any hands in and around. He's given frees very quick, and that's something that Glen are probably going to have to learn very quickly.
Yeah, Kieran McFaul seemed to be arguing with Brendan Colley there, and he left Kieran Sugrue to take the quick one sharp, and it allowed Connor Hand to get play back up and running, and more importantly, keep the ball in the hands of the men from Kiltum. Carrot looking to get away, worked inside as far as Paul McGrath. There was space in front of him, and he tried to knock it out to his left hand side, and it's been well broken down, and won by Cahill Mulholland. Just as Glen looked to build again with Emmett Bradley, carries it over the 45. Poor decisions at the wrong time inside the final third for St. Bridget's, and it's when Glen carry it forward. They just look so comfortable in possession. And just as the curse of the commentator, as I say that, it's kicked in long toward Danny Tallon, straight down the throat of a St. Bridget's sweeper.
But it's a two different styles. Whenever Glen win the ball back, they're very, very slow in their approach and their build-up. Very like Derry would do. They get two men up either side to get a man deep, so width and depth. Whereas St. Bridget's are absolutely flying to get up there as quick as they can.
Sent in, up the line by Robbie Dolan. Sent towards Ben O'Carroll, who was surrounded by three Glen men in the form of Michael Warnock, Connor Glass and Kieran McFaul. Caught possession of it. It was kicked from outside of the 45, so he's won an advance mark. Just to the right of centre by the time he kicks it on the 21-yard line. Left-footed effort from O'Carroll. Three for the day for him. And it extends that St. Bridget's lead. 6 points, place three. O'Carroll's causing a real headache for Michael Warnock inside.
Yeah, he is, and like, it's not often we have said that, and usually Warnock will find a way to get out, but they've been just so good, and they've found him, and because they've looked at him all the time, everybody's making space for him. You know, he doesn't have to do much other than get out in front, and he's so quick. He's got two good feet, and like, for any player, I suppose, if there's any doubt, he scored 7:32 in the lead up to today's final, you know, so it's probably no shock to a lot of people watching the game.
I suppose when Glen are just in everybody's vision for the last, I suppose they've been in everybody's vision in Derry and Ulster for the last three seasons, and I suppose they've came into the focus with the whole of Ireland after that All-Ireland club final last year. St. Bridget's sneaking under the radar. How many times have we seen teams come to Croke Park, nobody's talking about them, and they just upset the
odds? Yeah, they do, but look, teams coming with no tradition or no pedigree, it's different. You know, all these players played in Go games at half time 10 years ago. Brian Stack was there for the final, so they have the history and tradition, and that means something.
It certainly does. And here goes the familiar run of Ethan Doherty. Challenge came in from Rory Fallon, enough to impede him. He's held it too long though, the Maharaj man, and St. Bridget's waste absolutely no time getting play back up and running. He's just turned into the tackle though, Rory Fallon, of Tiernan Flanagan. He's went down on it, Robbie Dolan. He's surrounded by Glass and by Flanagan. He's went out over the sideline, forced out over the sideline. So we'll restart right on the 45 almost with Connor Glass. Malachy O'Rourke right out at the end of edge of that technical area, shouting instructions to Ryan Dugan and to Kieran McFaul. Connor Glass has it, slips it as far as Cahill Mulholland. Mulholland does well to hold on to possession. McFaul sends it from the left side of the 45 out to that right hand side, where Eunan Mulholland will look to come inside, happy to take a couple of solos. Space opens up for Conleth McGuckian and Tiernan Flanagan out on that right hand side. Slip from McFaul before slipping it as far as Conleth McGuckian. McGuckian comes inside, right booted. Is the wind going to catch that one and curl it outside of the post? The umpire to that right-hand side. Says it did, in fact. So the white count now sits at 5 for Glen. And Conlett, it's kicking towards the right of Hill 16. And the wind's just catching it and, I suppose, carrying it towards the scoreboard on the left. It's not exactly a wind advantage, you would call it, for Mara, would you?
Yeah, it's not. And it's where you get your positions. It's where Ethan Doherty. When Ethan Doherty's taken up his positions, and that's another great kick.
Fantastic kick out from Conor McShea.
I've yet to see Glen getting caught this way at any of the 3 years under Malachy O'Rourke. You know, so, and I can't really work out how they're getting so many free men here in the middle.
So St. Bridget's in possession of that elusive O'Neill's size 5. They're also in possession of a 3-point advantage after 24 and a half minutes of this All-Ireland Senior Club Football Championship final. I'm sure Jerome Stack will be happy with this start. There was the fast start against Corrifin that upset the odds and saw them lift the Connacht title. It was also the fast start that helped them pass Castlehaven. He's shirked a couple of challenges, Eddie Nolan, before unleashing it on that big left lever. That's an incredible kick from Eddie Nolan. St. Bridget's well on top in this contest so far when it comes to the scoring stack, 7-3.
Yeah, and just as I'd said before it, that Conor Glass could afford to drop off Nolan because he wasn't known for his point taking, and he kicks an absolutely worldly right into the Davin stand. And again, it's probably the sort of lead they deserve, and Eunan Mulholland has now went off for Conor Comfrey to come in, and that's a huge blow because possibly one of the players of their season, you know, has been Eunan Mulholland. He's kicked 7 points for a wing half back, which is incredible.
Comfrey gets on possession right away, sends it down that right hand side towards Alex Doherty, a real direct forward, takes it back. Comfrey doesn't know, just about stumbles between the 21 and the 14 and is forced backwards when the opportunity for a shot may have looked on. Ethan Doherty, though, works it back out as far as Jody McDermott. Here's Kieran McFall just outside of the D. Unleashes a shot on the right boot, Kieran McFall. That's a settler. Stops the rot for Glen. Kieran McFall, the man missing from last year, just gets the scoreboard back up and ticking. They went 7 minutes without one.
Yeah, and they needed that. And within those periods, St. Bridget had kicked 3 points, you know, so they probably needed that. But looking at that substitution, I'm wondering, was it tactical? Because whenever Eunan Mulholland came off, he didn't look particularly happy, and I'm wondering what they've seen that we haven't seen.
If there's no time for sentiment in an All-Ireland final, if a change needs to be made, it needs to be made.
That's incredibly well. Such skill.
Yeah, I think was it maybe Nolan again there to keep it inside and keep it in play and get it towards Ben O'Carroll. I don't know how O'Carroll kept possession of the football, but it's with Paul McGrath here. It's all very tight, and they're just comfortable in these tight positions.
It's an unbelievably incredible bit of skill. You know, the sideline was kicked in under pressure. He got his two under it. He had two men. He was on the ground, and yet still, for a small man, had the strength to get that, and they've got themselves a sideline, and he has just been unmarkable at this point.
Yeah, way out in the far side, front of the Cusick stand. Sideline taken towards Kieran Sugru. He's went down on it, Rory Fallon. Not exactly sure who's in possession of the football here or what he's going to give Brendan Colley. I think he's going to toss it up, which probably makes a little bit of sense because I don't think anybody could see what exactly was going on. So it's way out on that far side in front of the Cusick stand. The throw up is one deep inside that the Glen half by St. Bridget. Worked out back as far as Fallon lines up the shot on the right boot. It's going to hang in the air. It's going to look very, very good and climb inside that left-hand post. St. Bridget's economy in their shots is absolutely remarkable, and he's became their fifth different scorer, third of the team up and running, and a score's coming from everywhere. Yeah. St. Bridget's need.
And I suppose the big thing for Derry people watching this is you don't see Conor Glass ever out caught or out manoeuvred in a hot ball.
You never do. And the restart from Conlon Bradley is gathered, the breaking ball gathered by Conor Carville. Glen looking to carry it forward, but they're meeting the resistance of the St. Bridget's man. A lot of this time they're coming up short, and Jody McDermott played an incredible ball towards Alex Doherty, but he just couldn't gather it. Tried the soccer style knock it as far as Talon. Does find him in this attempt. It's a chance for Glen of a goal. They've worked it back in. It's into the back of the net. What about that for a response from the Derry and the Ulster champions?
And I think that was Jody McDermott. He started the move. He kicked the ball. I think he actually maybe overkicked it. I think he was lucky in the first instance. Doherty done well. Talon could have taken a point, but that's the difference in the goal chance, I suppose, that Bridget's got. Glen could have took a point, but they were ruthless. And that's what teams at the top level do.
Yeah, the ball inside from Jody McDermott. It went as far as Alex Doherty. Soccer styled it and got possession to Talon. Talon thought about maybe having the shot. Talon thought about maybe fisting it over the bar. Talent slipped it as far as Jody McDermott, and McDermott busted it right down the middle, and the Teals are certainly up for the Derry and the Ulster champions now as Ethan Doherty wins that breaking ball, carries it forward to the edge of the D. Doherty lets go on the right foot, and the umpires on this occasion look for the white flag, and in the blink of an eye, from 4 points down, Glen are level.
Yeah, and it's just their ability there to get the goal and then press high. And the one thing that you would say is she has been brilliant off the tee, but Glen forced them 50-50 like they did Kilmacud in the key moments. And then obviously that's 1-1 with no reply then.
1-1 in literally the blink of an eye, in a matter of seconds. And that's what good teams do. They can drag themselves back into contests. And many occasions we've seen the great Dublin teams look like they were maybe struggling and just bring themselves right back into contention, and that's exactly what Watty Graham's Glen, the Derry and the Ulster champions, have done here. 1-1 without reply. They need a response in Brigid's, and it's the veteran Brian Stack carrying it forward, finds Eddie Nolan. Nolan trying to make gains, but he's forced backwards as far as Shane Cunnan. Cunnan slips the pass, space opens up for the shot, just does look at it for a moment, the St. Brigid's player, potentially Roland Stack, who took that shot, but it went to the left and wide. And we're 5 seconds into injury time, but there will be 1 minute of additional time at the end of this first half, which the St. Brigid's have bossed and will probably be disappointed to go in level. That's if they do, in fact, survive the next 40 seconds or so. Conlon Bradley finds his brother, Emmett. Lots of space inside, but it's going to run forward. He just thought about it, Pierce Frost, before going across and gathering it. It looked like it might have been Danny Talon's ball to win, but does well to slip it as far as Robbie Dolan. St. Brigid's will try to get the last score before half-time. 15 seconds of the added one additional time left, so this should be the last attack of the first half if they do try to carry themselves forward, because it could be on the blow from Brendan Colley.
Yeah, well, St. Brigid's, they were in the half, they need to take a chance,
they
probably
need to push forward,
just get a shot away, because the referee will blow it up now.
And he does blow it up. Minutes to decide the destination of the Andy Murrigan Cup for 2024, and it's Emmett Bradley who wins the throw-up, sends it forward towards Conor Convery, a late replacement in that first half, taking the place of Eunan Mulholland. We're not exactly sure if that was injury-related or it was a tactical move from the Glen boss, Malachy O'Rourke. Whatever it was, it helped anyway, because in that period, Glen went on to hit a goal on the point. And it's a nice move straight away from Glen. It's Conath McGuckian who's bursting away towards the 14, goes down under the challenge, works it back out. The opportunity for the shot is a block down from Cahill Mulholland, and it gives St. Brigid's the chance to venture forward with it. It's a loose hand pass, but Paul McGrath, soccer star of his name, and it was soccer style from McGrath to send it forward and keep St. Brigid's in possession. Worked on it on this left-hand side with a Connor hand. Sends it up the left-hand side in front of the Hogan stand. Plays a 1-2 with Ronan Stack, the sole survivor from that 2013 victory. The only time that the Roscommon club have won the All-Ireland club title. They too did lose a final before winning it at home. It's an omen that has repeated itself like a domino effect with Kilcoo and with Kilmacud Crokes. Glen hoping to become the latest at Ben O'Carroll, the man who caused real problems in the first half for Mahara. It's Bobby Nugent who's really, really well marshalled there by Kieran McFaul, and they're forced back out. Happy though to try and keep possession of the football. The rain has stayed away in the early stages of the second half as it's worked back towards O'Carroll. It's an opportunity for St. Brigid's goal. Spits across and pounded into the back of the net. Brian Derwin. And what about that? 90 seconds into the second stanza, St. Brigid's burst through the possession in the hands of O'Carroll. He had the presence of mind to flick it across to Brian Derwin. He put it into the empty net, and that 3-point lead re-established for the Roscommon and Connacht champions. But Connacht Gilligan, Croke Park loves drama, and that's
yeah, that was incredible. Bobby Nugent deserves the credit. A backdoor cut and a kick pass at the top drawer, but again, Ben O'Carroll wasn't selfish. He threw it across for Derwin, but as Johnny McBride talked about, What did Monica Rourke want? The first settling score. Glen made a mess of it, getting blocked down by Mulholland, taking a shot when it wasn't on, which is uncharacteristic, and they paid the ultimate price for it.
They certainly have. It's all about the response now. Take a look down, and Monica Rourke never looks too phased. He's just in conversation with his management team. Not the ideal start, 90 seconds into a second half of an All-Ireland final, but if there's a team that's risen through adversity throughout the years.
Yeah, and look, it's not, if you're going to concede a goal, it's the best time you can, because you've got 30 minutes to get inside it. The danger for Glen is if the longer it takes him to get back to level terms, Brigid are going to get another purple patch, and it's what happens in that time. How far can Glen eat into that lead before Brigid get another score?
And certainly is. Kieran McFaul works it out towards Emmett Bradley in front of the Hogan stand, cuts inside in the left with Emmett Bradley. It's high and it's wild. It's almost like Ben O'Carroll's first effort on that side, but St. Bridget haven't been able to deal with it until this point. It's going to fall into the hands of Alex Doherty, worked back out towards Conor Glass, worked in a loop from the 14 back as far as the 45 with Ethan Doherty. He's able to slip it to Michael Warnock, who did kick a point in that semi-final victory over Kilmacud Crokes. Kieran McFaul got one in the first half. He sent that one high, he sent that one wide. The white card for the Ulster champions is now 6, and that's a worry that I'm sure Monica Rourke addressed at halftime. But Kieran McFaul is one of the men you probably want to.
And again, he's the one player that loves kicking across himself like that, and how many times have you seen him doing that? But again, it's just a wee bit unsettled. You know, they haven't really got to the pitch of it, and look at that short kick out.
He just let Nolan run.
Yeah, then. When have Glen ever looked as shaky as that, you know?
And here's Robbie Dolan. It's one-on-one inside between Ben O'Carroll and with Ryan Duggan. Ryan Duggan, of course, was, I thought about it, he could miss this game with a hamstring injury, but he stood up and he's looked through the whites of the eyes of O'Carroll, and he's forced him backwards. It's a nice move into the hands of Alan Daly, a man who replaced Luke Eastland before the game, throwing in at this point.
Yeah, and there's an interesting change. Outside of the right, oh, what a score.
Effort comes in from Brian Derwin. The space opened up for Derwin. Has a go with the outside of the right boot. Curled it between the sticks. A goal and a point early in this second half for Brian Derwin. And talked about the influence of Ben O'Carroll. Well, Brian Derwin is becoming a thorn in the Derry champion side.
And again, how interesting it is. They made the switch after the goal, and Ryan Duggan has went to mark Brian Carroll, which left Derwin on somebody a wee bit smaller, and that made all the difference.
Certainly has, and all of a sudden it's a 4-point lead, but that 4-point lead could be cut away because the ball's knocked as far as Danny Tallon. Has a man inside him. Conleth McGough in with a shot, and what a fantastic block in there from Pierce Frost. Snuffed the danger out, got across, blocked in front of McGough, and that was a real opportunity for a response for Glen. It will go for a 45 though, which I just see Conor Glass having a look at his socks and making sure there's none of the Croke Park turf in his studs. But another huge moment, and here there's not a skill like the bravery of a block and Pierce Frost across.
And the one
there.
Thing you expect for Conleth McGuckin, he's really, really, really good in those situations for a wee dummy to come in. But again, he just wanted the shot away, he wanted it to happen. The goal really wasn't on, but if Conor Glass has ever had a more important 45, I haven't seen it.
So Conor Glass standing over this 45 kick just to the right of centre, strikes it well, Glass strikes it right between the sticks. Just as Glen needed him, when Derry needed him, he steps up, cuts the gap back down to a kick of the ball between them. Fine strike from the turf.
And the thing it does, it allows Glen to get their kick out press so they could possibly get the ball. But it's really important now that Glen do get the next score just to eat into that lead.
First score of the second half, which is 6 minutes old. It's the second of the day for Conor Glass. Already kicked one from play, nailed that 45. It's another great kick out from Cormac Sheehy. And that ball spilled out via Ronan Stack. Looked like Ethan Doherty got a hand on it, but he was already outside of the playing surface. Ethan Doherty takes it quickly to his Derry teammate Conor Glass. Alex Doherty gets it, slips along the 45 metre line, does seem to go down in pain, but nope, he's working his way back up again. Glass was able to find Kieran McFaul, and Kieran McFaul carries it out on the left hand side towards the Cusick stand, looks inside. Kieran McFaul does have a go on that right boot, unloads it, it's going to drop in a dangerous position, but on this occasion from Kieran McFaul it's dropped just short of the retired targets, and it went to the left and wide. 7 the wide count, and that's 2 early wides from Kieran McFaul.
Yeah, and that's his 3rd wide in total, and they were all in scoreable positions for a player of his talent. And you know, while he hasn't been as influential as he was the last day, he's still getting in a lot of ball and he's getting his scoring chances. It'd be more worrying if he wasn't getting the chances.
So Cormac Ashie in goals for St. Bridget sends it towards his full back, and it's Well, it looked like it was Danny Tallon's ball to win, but he couldn't gather it, and Brian Snack was able to gather possession. St. Bridget's have it, looking to work a move forward with Connor Hand. He's able to take a hand a tilt, able to take a bounce and carry it out this right-hand side, where he finds the big midfielder, Shane Cannan, who was one of those St. Bridget's players that played in the halftime Go games in 2013, inspired what he's seen from that great team. Ben O'Carroll gets on it, takes a 1-2 with Bobby Nugent. O'Carroll working it from right to left. Here's centre forward Kieran Sugru on the 45. Centre half back is Ronan Stack, plenty of experience. One of the players that when this game goes into the melting pot in the real championship rounds has the experience of winning on the big day.
And the interesting thing structurally, that Brian Derwin is at full forward, Conor Glass has had to go to full back now because Dugan's out of there, so that leaves him more vulnerable around the middle.
Derwin just very poor in possession there, looked for O'Carroll but sent the ball into the hands of Cahill Mulholland, who carries it forward for Glen. Just enters into the St. Bridget's half before finding Gunnar Mulholland. The tackle came in from Connor Hand. Connor Glass able to pick up the scraps though, as Ethan Doherty carries it forward, worked back out as far as Alex Doherty, back with Flanagan. Glen just not able to force it into a central position, that's occupied by black jerseys. Glass finds the run of Conleth McGuckian. McGuckian sends it high in the sky, doesn't have the required legs. It's going to be dangerous in there for Sheehy, who punches it. And thankfully for him, it's going to fall into the hands of Rory Fallon. That was a dangerous moment. Another opportunity goes a-begging, and it's a chance for the counter-attack for St. Bridget's.
And the bigger issue is for Glen that Conleth McGuckian has checked one wide and two short. McFall's checked three, and nobody really looks like they want to take a shot on, because the two or three positions earlier, better than that. But look, it's still worrying from a Bridges point of view. Glen look like they're cutting them open, especially as they're not playing probably to the best of their ability.
That probably is a point. 39 minutes played on BBC Radio Foyle and BBC Sounds. You're listening to the All-Ireland Senior Club Football Championship Final. It's St. Bridget's of County Roscommon, a goal and 9 points. It's Watty Graham's Glen of County Derry, a goal and six. That's 12 points playing nine, a 3 point advantage for the men from the west of Ireland. And they are in possession of the football. Emmett Bradley went across to make things difficult, but it was Bobby Nugent who was able to gather it back with Shane Cannan. Flicks it over the head of Conleth McGuckian and is able to find Nugent once again, who's closely marshalled from Michael Warnock. Cannan again looks for options. That's a poor pass over the head of the intended target.
But they'd nowhere to hit. Glen have pushed up heavy man to man and they look like they've had their beaten. So Bridges couldn't get out there. It's really good play from Glen to turn over that ball.
And it's so simple, Colin.
Yeah, look, it's simple in theory. In practice, getting everybody in tune is very difficult.
Here's Conor Glass surrounded by 3-4 Bridget's men. Overzealous in their approach to the tackle and send the big midfielder to the ground illegally, says Brendan Colley. Here's Jody McDermott, who got that first half goal for Glen. Unleashes it on his left foot. It's going to curl in the sky. It's going to curl to the right and wide. And the wide count ever growing for Malachy O'Rourke's team. It now stands at 8. And it's an opportunity, Conor, that, dare I say, you should be nailing.
You should. And like, had Jack Doherty been in that position, he probably would have sized his man up and went in and bought a free. And I suppose, interestingly, the one thing that Glen do is they run at teams that draw frees. They haven't been able to do that today.
Another restart from Cormac Sheehy. It's going to run over the top of everybody's heads. It's going to be mopped up by Conor Glass. He seems to be in the right place at the right time in all occasions. That was a difficult ball that Michael Warnock sent him, but Glass was able to gather it. Here's Emmett Bradley back with Jody McDermott. Kieran McFall between the 14 and the 21. Kieran McFall, when that looked like the easiest of efforts, I don't know if he was off balance because he ended up in on the turf. He hit it high in the sky, skewed it to the left and wide. Three wides early in this second half for Kieran McFall.
Yeah, Kieran McFall bought a duck today, it would drown. That's just the day he's having. He's just having no luck. He needs something to settle him. But again, he's getting into positions. And now Glen have done what the characters usually do. They put in the high press. And at this stage, St. Bridget's haven't got any of the last three kickouts.
He bought a duck, he would drown. I can't say I've heard that one before, Conleth. But anyway, back with possession of the football, which is won by St. Bridget's. It's won with their centre forward, Kieran Sugru. O'Carroll sends it over the top. It's another really, really poor hand pass towards Bobby Nugent. It escapes him and it's in the hands of Michael Warnock, the ever reliable Michael Warnock. Talking about reliability, the man almost playing like a quarterback, able to take it off Warnock when the danger may have been lurking was Conor Glass. There's a Glen man down in the centre of the field. We're not exactly sure who it is at this point. It's Conor Carville, the captain. He's receiving treatment from the physio, but play does go on with Ethan Doherty, happy to cut through some of the defence, but the opportunity and space in front of him wasn't exactly there. Conor Convery able to find Emmett Bradley, able to see with those bright ready orange sort of boots, and he's already kicked a couple of points in that first half. Emmett Bradley in the left boot, but doesn't exactly suit him out there at the minute. Cuts back in towards the left hand side. The foul from the Brigid's man, says Brendan Colley. So it'll be an opportunity for Danny Tallon to have a shot and goal. And Tallon burst onto the scene after about a minute in last year's final. And Danny Tallon has hardly touched leather today.
No, he hasn't had his best game after having a really good final last year. But all it takes is something just to ignite the fire and a free from a very difficult position, it must be said. But
the left leg of Conor Carville, we see the replay in front of us. It's been stretched out to the left knee, maybe, is it, with the physio?
Yeah, and he looks to be in a bit of distress, but he's up and he's moving. But it's a case now, if you look at what St Bridges are doing, Paul McGrath now seems to be trying to sweep, and all that's allowing, and there's going to be a change here. He is in trouble. There is going to be a change.
Conor Carville looks over, so it'll be another forced substitution for Glen. When play does get back up and running, though, he's got his hands in his head, the Glen captain. Horrible way for your All-Ireland club final day to end. And he's such an influence on the field of play and in defence for Glen. We're waiting to see who exactly will replace him.
Yeah, I'm just wondering, will they look at bringing Stevie O'Hara maybe on and pushing somebody else back? But I don't think that's who it is.
It looks at this juncture that they're going to throw.
Yeah, it's number 19. It is Stevie O'Hara.
Yeah, is going to go in.
I just think in a game like this where you need a big shooter, that from range, he is that player. He has done it before. And it just means probably pushing the likes of Conliffe McGuckin back a line. And that's probably going to be the switch.
So Conor Carville's day is over. He's replaced by Stevie O'Hara. And 43 minutes gone. Brigid's a goal in 9. Glen a goal in 6. The ball in the hands of Danny Tallon. Round about 35 yards from goal. Almost on that left touchline. Sits the right footer. This kick sends it high in the sky. Danny Tallon, is it going to have the legs? No, it's not. It's going to drop right on the goal line, where a St Bridget's man was able to grasp it with relative comfort. But it's going to be difficult to get out because Glen are pushing high in. The man on it is Brian Derwin, was able to find a ball up that left hand side, and straight away in possession is Rory Fallon, was able to find the run of Robbie Dolan, sends it in towards O'Carroll. It's O'Carroll and Dugan. O'Carroll looked to try and take him on soccer style. Dugan has stood him up, and he touched it on the ground there. I think Brendan Colley is gesturing. Yes, he is. So it was out on the left corner. St Bridget's aren't too happy with that one, and they're making a substitution. The man coming on is John Cunningham, who will replace Brian Derwin, who scored a goal and a point in this second half.
And I think what has happened is that whenever they made the switch, you look at the influence of Michael Warnock since that, he's probably been there, but that was great. Dugan, since he has went on to Ben O'Carroll, has been brilliant. You know, that's twice now he's kept him out, and physically he's got the strength, he's got the beating of him, and you just feel that Glen now have got the momentum behind them, but they have to eat into that score, because the more that clock ticks toward 50 minutes, it just gets harder and harder.
Yeah, John Cunningham for Brian Derwin after 44 minutes, the exact change that was made in the semi-final. You have to wonder, do managers plan these things out beforehand? You would like to think they maybe do. Stevie O'Hara, first touch for him. Glen have it inside the St Bridge. It's a 45. Kieran McFall back as far as Stevie O'Hara. Conlon Gilligan said he's one of those big shooters. Stevie O'Hara has a go at the outside of the left foot, and Stevie O'Hara only adds to the Glen wide count, which is now into double figures, 10 wides for the Ulster champions. And the opportunity was there, didn't strike it cleanly at all. Conlon,
yeah, and look, the big thing for Glen, they've had 10 scoring chances in this half and they've scored 1 point. If you compare that, all that St Bridget's had is the goal chance and the chance for a point. They've only had 2 shots on goal. Glen have been so dominant, it's just incredible that they haven't been able to get closer here.
Cormac Sheehy sends the kick out to his right hand side. It seemed to be won in the air by Conor Glass, who Brendan Colley, the match referee, says he was infringed while he was in the air. The St Bridget's fans, as we can see over there in the Cusick stand, weren't too happy with that decision, and when we get a look at it on the replay, it probably looks like a fair enough decision.
Yeah, and all these things help St Bridget, because now the clock starts to become their friend. The longer Glass stays in the ground, Glen need the game to flow. The stop-start nature of it isn't helping them at this point.
Ethan Doherty on it. Ethan Doherty, well, I was going to say loses it, but he was fouled along the way, and Brendan Colley's awarded another free to the Derry champions out on the 45. Conor Glass is the man who is looking to get play back underway.
Yeah, and I just thought with him kicking the 45 earlier that he may have had a go for that.
Yeah, it probably would have suited him on the right boot also, but happy enough to knock it back as far as Flanagan, who finds Emmett Bradley out on this right hand side with Danny Tallon. Danny Tallon cuts inside, able to find Kieran McFall. Kieran McFall has had 3 shots so far in the second half, and he's skewed all of them. McFaul looks for options as he crosses the 14. He's,
and it's just everybody's just hesitant to shoot now, the fear of missing. And they need somebody to break up and lead.
And it's Conor Glass who's able to find Tiernan Flanagan. Tiernan Flanagan's effort is wild and it's going to fall down short of the required target. It's going to be won by Brian Stack, and St. Bridget's have possession of the football. There's two players tangling inside in there, and Brandon Colley's going to stop it for that. It'll be interesting to see if his umpires or indeed his linesmen have seen everything. It's Bobby Nugent and potentially Cahill Mulholland. It's a is it a black card?
It looks like a black card. Yeah, it looks like a black card.
I did just catch that, and Cahill Mulholland did in fact pull down Bobby Nugent as he was going out. It's probably a very silly thing. So there's 47 minutes on the clock. Cahill Mulholland's gone for 10. So Watty Graham's Glen are 3 points down. They're down to 14 men. And you talk about stop-start nature and things working out for you. Look, we see the replay there. There's absolutely no need for Cahill Mulholland to pull him down there. And I'm sure Malachy O'Rourke's going to be absolutely furious with that also.
Yeah, it is. And the worrying nature for Glen now is that the extra man that they had to push on kickouts they don't have. So the kickouts now become nearly null and void unless they go and put Conlon Bradley right into the mix for kickouts, which in itself is problematic.
I remember it was the final at Slot the Hill. Everybody thought they were going to win against Dr. Crokes, and on that day it was a red card for Padraig Cassidy. And the big screens at Croke Park just showed that Mickey Moore, and the Slot the Hill manager that day, with his head in his hands. The cameras just panned today to Malachy O'Rourke, and he'll be hoping that it's not a similar vein of 14 men costing a Derry club on All-Ireland Club Final Day against a team from the west of Ireland, against the Connacht champions. And it's the Connacht champions in possession. It's a nice turn of pace from Murray Fallon. Murray Fallon on the right foot splits the post, sends it over the black spot. He extends the St. Bridget's lead back out to 5 points. That's an incredible score.
Yeah, it is. But it's just the fact that that extra man, the goalkeeper, came out and made an extra position, and Murray Fallon was able to break through. But look, you talk about efficiency, that's 1-2 from three shots for St. Bridget's. And now St. Bridget's don't really have to go mad on the checkout because they've that extra man sweeping. Look, I still think Glen can win this game, but they're going to need the next score.
They certainly are. That was a first score in 13 minutes for St. Bridget's. The Connacht champions, their lead is 1-10, 1-6-4 between them. We're into the final 11 minutes of the contest. Conlon did talk about how the scoreboard, or sorry, the timing can become a friend, but the ball's knocked in towards Alex Doherty. It looked dangerous, but it's well covered, and it's just a silly, silly push from the St. Bridget's defender in there, and that should be a simple tap over free. And he's going to call in Emmett Bradley on the left foot to take this, because it's one low, it's simple, it really needs to go between the sticks.
Yeah, and if Malachy O'Rourke's going to be crossed with Mulholland, then I would imagine Jerome Stack is going to be absolutely fuming. Alex Doherty was bending, running away from goal, and it lived a very easy free, and now it just allows them the chance. So if we're looking in here, Conlon Bradley is going to come up for the kick out. That's what it has to be. You have to go for it here, because you cannot give them out balls.
So Emmett Bradley stands over this free, left-footed from the 14-yard line, sends it between the sticks, kicking the ball back between the sides, 3 points. Johnny McBride eagle-eyed alongside us, and he can spy that Ewan Mulholland, who was taken off in that first half by Malachy O'Rourke, is now back out warming up. So obviously we assume then that it wasn't injury related. We have seen in All-Ireland finals before of players being taken off and brought back on again. And Conor Glass, who wins that resulting kick out from Cormac Sheehy, Glen wasting no time in getting play back up and running. It's with Ethan Doherty. It's sent inside towards Alex Doherty. Alex Doherty looks to get away from Frost. It's blocked though, and it's going to be dangerous in there for Cormac Sheehy, who does well to come out and win it. There was a heavy, heavy knock on potentially Danny Tallon, so he will stop play for a head injury assessment, as both Cormac Sheehy and Danny Tallon will require treatment. And Conlith, if we see Ewan Mulholland down there warming up again, and if he was to come back in, because Glen probably are light of options in the bench in terms of many of actually played
because they had to go to the bench early. They've a lot of players that are very young. You know, the Lexi Cahar McCabe played a lot of football last year, but has been kind of out of the mix this year. Obviously, and all the other injuries that have been there, they're just untried and untested, and sometimes you need somebody you can trust. And again, he's one of those players. He, as Johnny touched on, and he's probably right, he was the player so far of the championship for Glen, and they're probably going to need something different, because the longer this game gets into this, closer to 60 minutes, the harder it's going to be for Glen, because they're going to have to maybe go for a goal. If St. Bridges can get another point and leave it a 2-score game, it just leaves it all the more insurmountable.
Yeah, as Ewan Mulholland climbs up the steps of the Hogan Stand alongside the tunnel, Johnny has pointed him out, and we do in fact see that he does a strapping on his left leg, so that might look into why Malachy O'Rourke was it was maybe an enforced change. bringing Union Mulholland off, but he's still out there and he is still available for selection should Malachy O'Rourke require him. So we've now played 52 minutes of this All-Ireland Senior Club football final on BBC Radio 4 and on BBC Sounds. It's St Bridget's, a goal in 10, 13 points. It's Glen, a goal in 7, 10 points. A 3-point advantage for the men from the west of Ireland. They're in possession of the football, but it looks like O'Carroll could be stripped of it here. Again, he's done so well in possession. He's able to knock it back as far as forward as Eddie Nolan. Nolan has possession. Nolan is dispossessed by one of the players in there. I think it was maybe Emmett Bradley who got a big hand in there to win back possession for his team. He did, in fact. Yeah, but it's spilled again.
Here's the big thing for Glen. The referees will always go with the team chasing. Bridget's could have got two frees there. The referee let it go. And this is what Glen have to do. They're getting the benefit of the doubt. They have to benefit from those, though.
Yeah, just as we see the replay of that, Conlon McGuckian did get his foot to the ball just before Van O'Carroll went down. So full credit to the match official there, Brendan Colley, for spying that. It's Conlon Bradley in possession of the football. Finds Conlon McGuckian with it. Van O'Carroll back on his feet, receiving treatment after that. McGuckian was able to find Conor Glass. Glass now wasting no time, taking it inside the one half of St Bridget's. He's worked back out across the 45 is Conor Glass. He's happy just to take all the tackles that look very high. No advantage given from Brendan Colley. And it's going to fall back in to the fullback. The fullback of St Bridget's is Brian Stack.
Yeah, like that's a free all day long. Conor Glass, he done everything right. He took the tackle high. He played on waiting, thinking it was an advantage and it didn't come. That was a very poor decision from Colley.
It certainly did. It's maybe as if Colley didn't give the free at one end, so he wasn't going to give it at the other. But it did certainly look very high, and he's given the advantage this time as far as Conor Hand, who has it right in centre field. What he does with possession of the football, just urgent calm for those around him, and sends it out to his right hand side, right out in front of the Cusick stand.
Yeah, the next score is going to be massive no matter which way it goes. If you looked at how the hurling went, even with a man down, the next score, once you can keep it into a one score game, anything can happen. If Bridget stretch it to 4, it is very difficult. If Glen get it into 2, Bridget don't have the experience at this level and they will get very edgy.
Yeah, it certainly is the championship round. Emmett Bradley's late winner against Niamh Connell, edging them the line literally with the last kick. But it's Kieran Sugrue who's in possession of the football. It's St Bridget's who have it. Here's Alan Daly. It's in front of the Hogan stand now, right out on that left touchline, trying to work an opportunity, trying to work a score. John Cullingham, another substitution, he's on it. He's well marshalled though by Tiernan Flanagan. He's forced to go all the way back as far as his goalkeeper. Goalkeeper Cormac Sheehy, bright pair of orange boots for a man wearing number 1. That wouldn't have happened in Conlon Gilligan or Johnny McBride's day, but it's carried forward now by Pierce Frost. He's inside the Glen half. He's got plenty of room in front of him, but he doesn't have many options, so he's forced backwards also to the fullback Brian Stack, who carries it over the 65, carries it well into the Glen half of play. He's able to find Conor Glass in front of him, but he kicks it in towards Robbie Dolan. It's a nice move, it's a lovely move, and it's going to be dispatched between the sticks. St Bridget's all about their composure. It was Eddie Nolan, the man who finished the run and finished the ball between the sticks.
Yeah, and it's 2 more minutes now until Glen get their extra man on. And will that be time enough? Ciarán McCabe is going to enter the fray here now for Alex Doherty. You know, and he didn't play a huge amount this year. But a 4-point game is different. Now it very much looks like Glen need the next score and they may need a goal.
It certainly looks that way. 2 scores between them, 4 points between them. That substitution there, Ciarán McCabe on in place of Alex Doherty. So Malachy O'Rourke going to the deepest regions of his bench in hoping that his side can turn this game on its head with 4.5 minutes left.
And the big thing for Glen as well is that there could be anything up to 4 to 5 minutes, so it's not panicking.
Yeah, we had a extended period of injury time in the hurling, such as the stoppages now and the clock that the referees will have to watch. Here's Jody McDermott, thought about the shot, didn't want it. Here's Michael Warnock, did kick a point in the semi-final. Michael Warnock's clipped that one between the sticks. That's absolutely inspirational for Michael Warnock. He kicked one when Glen needed him most in that semi-final win over Kilmacott Crokes. He's wearing 2 on his back, but he looked like an experienced corner forward. A kick of the ball back between them, Conor.
A very difficult day for Warnock defensively, but when you need leadership, you need somebody to step up that's going to just let you live in the game. No better man. He's great going forward, and he showed serious character when nobody else wanted to take a shot on. And if anything is going to get them back into it, it's going to be that. And we can see now Conlon Bradley's coming right up for the kicker.
Yes, as St Bridget's make a substitution of their own, Conor Gleeson will replace Bobby Nugent. So this kick out huge. Conlon Bradley's came all the way up. Conlon Bradley has broken it down into Glen hands and taking it back off him, sent it back up the line towards Conleth McGuckian. Danny Tallon's also there. Tallon knocks it back towards McGuckian. McGuckian tried to knock it off one of the Bridges players to try and wind a sideline ball, and he's fouled the St. Bridges defender in the period, so it'll be a free out to the Roscommon men.
Yeah, and look, Cathal Mulholland's ready to come on now. His time's up in another 20 seconds.
So, Glenn, that was a 10-minute sin bin for the Black Yard for Cathal Mulholland. So, the Derry champions very, very soon will be restored back to the full 15, so it'll be 15 on 15.
Yeah, I think it's actually happened now, because I've seen him down there at the sideline and he's not there, so I think he must be in.
He's just about to come in. He's in the technical area. I think he's standing alongside. And Glenn have won possession back at the football. It's with Conor Glass, the 21, and Conor Glass into the back of the net. The St. Bridget's defence seemed to be sleeping. The high ball came in towards Conor Glass, and with Cormac Shee almost slightly off his line, Glass saw the opportunity and smashed the ball into the back of the net. And once again, with 2.5 minutes of normal time remaining, Glen are level.
Yeah, and he had time to get all in, and now just at that, Warnock comes in. They're now man to man, and now all bets are off again. It looked like 4 points was going to be insurmountable, but Glass has led from start to finish. Him and Warnock, when the game was looked dead and buried, they have stepped up, and if they're going to win this game, they'll probably need a statue to Conor Glass.
Yes, a clutch play from the big player, and it's St. Bridget's in possession now with Brian Stack. They're the team that needs a response with 2 minutes of normal time left. Their lead of 4 points that they looked so comfortable with has been clutched back. It's kicked inside towards Ben O'Carroll. Dugan went down and didn't win it. O'Carroll's block is an incredible block in there. Inspirational stuff from Cathal Mulholland, who's just back on after that black card, and he was able to get to the boot of O'Carroll and stop what surely would have been a score for a player of O'Carroll's quality.
Yeah, and sometimes things happen and you can't understand it, you can't explain it, and this is one of those things. Glen have been so poor in this half, they look dead and buried, but all of a sudden Ben O'Carroll, Cathal Mulholland comes on, he gives that block, and it's just everything is now swung completely in the way of Glen.
And it was, you talked about it, was Conlon Bradley pushing right up and Sheehy's kick out, and they won it. And I don't know how St. Bridget's actually managed to lose that sideline ball at the far side, but anyway, here come Glen again looking for a score to put them into the lead. It was Alex Doherty who sent it towards Danny Tallon. It's going to be picked up from Conleth McGuckian. The tails are up now from the Glen men. He cuts away Johnny McDermott. He looked for a foul, he didn't get it, and the match referee says no. St. Bridget's are going to have it in there. They're well bunched up, and it's back in Glen hands once again. Ethan Doherty gives it to Conor Glass. Emmett Bradley tried to work back round for the opportunity on the left foot, but he has it between the 45 and the 65, and he's able to find Michael Warnock.
And so this is the stage you can't buy experience. Glen know what to do in these big moments,
and here comes Warnock's. Michael Warnock, and he just can't get the shot away. It's a poor, it's in a weak effort, and it was able to be gathered by the St. Bridget's man. Will he give a free out here, Brenton Colley?
He will,
in fact.
He will. And here's the thing, Bridget's have never been here. Glen have been here last year, they've been here the year before, they've went to extra time with Kilcoo. They know what it takes when the game's coming down the stretch, and that's the big difference. For me, there's only one winner here.
Momentum, certainly with the Derry champions. Experience, you would think, does tell. We're 5 minutes of additional time. We've got 10 seconds left of normal time, so 5 minutes of fresh air allowed at the end of this game. St. Bridget's have kicked away possession of the football. It's in the hands of Emmett Bradley, who gives it to Ryan Dugan. Ethan Doherty has a lot of space in front of him out to the right of the field. St. Bridget's men do come to join him. It's flicked back in as far as Conor Convery. Convery looks to have been foiled. Convery is in fact fouled by Pierce Cross. Brendan Colley played the advantage, but there is no advantage. It should be a simple tap over free, and imagine it'll be the left foot of Emmett Bradley, who's just taking his time and walking in, hands on hips.
5 minutes, as we talked about, with 5 minutes to go in normal time. Now people panic, but you're always going to get 3, 4, 5 minutes. If it's 30 seconds for every sub, 5 minutes is a huge length of time now.
And if Glen get ahead, they're a team that like to counter-attack St. Bridget's. They've had their noses in front for so long, but if they're the team that may have to just push up and force the effort, because Emmett Bradley standing almost straight in front of the goals, just slight angle which suits the left footer. Emmett Bradley has already got 2 scores today. Emmett Bradley standing over this free to put Glen back into the lead, slips it between the crossbar. Glen back in front in this contest. 4 minutes left of the 5 additional time, so it's Glen 2 goals and 9 points, which is 15 points. It's St. Bridget's of Roscommon, a goal on 11, which is 14. Cormac Sheehy's kick out now, all the play for, punched by Conor Glass, sent back in the direction that Ethan Doherty carries it forward. We talk about the clutch players in the big moments. Glass and Doherty have been absolutely incredible. Here's another man who's been incredible for Glen all year, Conleth McGuckian. It's good for Conleth McGuckian. It's very, very good. It seemed to hang in the air for an eternity, but it found its destination between the sticks in front of the Davin stand. The Glen supporters, as we can see in the Cusick stand, they're trying to sense now, starting to sense that it might be their day. And Conlith,
yeah, it's taken an hour, but Glen have finally found their groove. The problem, I suppose, that Bridget's had in the second half, they haven't been able to get any of their own kickouts.
Three kickouts in a row go astray from St Bridget's, and now, well, we talk about Ulster football being the best in the land, and the Ulster champions look like they will become the All-Ireland champions in the club game for 2024. Conor Glass, Ethan Doherty, the big players, the county men that have stood up for Derry in the Ulster Championship throughout the last while, they put Derry back on the map in inter-county level. They're going to put their club, by the looks of things, to the top of proceedings in the whole of Ireland. It looked like it was going to slip away from them. 62 minutes and 15 seconds played at Croke Park. It's Glen who leads St Bridget's by 2 points. They're happy enough just to keep possession of the football. It's with Michael Warnock. Warnock happy enough just to keep it and find Conlon Bradley as goalkeeper, who's also quite astute in holding it. He liked to play outfield himself, said he didn't even like to go in nets when he was playing five-a-side soccer. So his attributes out the field will be well known. There's plenty of space opening up for Glen. And here they come once again. It slipped as far as Conlon McGuckian. McGuckian who put that score to put them two ahead. It could be another sealer. Fists over the bar, Conlon McGuckian. No, he hasn't. He's put it to the right and wide.
Yeah, and I suppose, look, at a two-point game, that fist over the bar makes it three, and it's done and dusted. A two-point game still leaves it a score, and we've seen in club finals over the last number of years, a lot of silly things can happen with high balls in. Bridget's will get one other chance at a high ball. It will take a goal, but Glen with Dugan and Glass, it's very hard to see them losing in that position.
Cormac Sheehy finally got one of his kickouts off as far as Gleeson. Gleeson won it, and it's St Bridget who will attack in front of the Hogan stand. We've got a minute and a half, 90 seconds left to play of this contest. Ben O'Carroll, the man who you'll want to make things happen for St Bridget's, is exactly who Jerome Stack will want on the ball. Jerome, has he got it? Ben O'Carroll, the umpires have a look at each other. They don't exactly know what to do. Are we going to go for Hawkeye here? Or has Brenton Colley brought it back for a free? It looks like he's maybe brought it back for a free.
Yeah, he's brought it back for a free. It looked like it went wide at that stage, but a free, and it just means that it gives them an opportunity now. And if you keep it within 3 points, you always have a chance.
Yes, interestingly, it's Shane Cunanan on the right boot who's going across to take this free. It suits the right footer. He's got going to take it off the ground, which maybe tells you what the conditions are like for shooters today.
Yeah, very much down that side. Like, Glen struggled in the first half, and obviously the thing was all the points and all the scores have came either outside of the left at that side or in front of the goal.
So it's Shane Cunanan strikes it from 21 yards. It just creeps inside of that left post. So we've got 50 seconds left on the clock, a single point between them, all to play for in this All-Ireland Senior Club Football Championship Final. Glen 2-10, 16 points. St Bridget's 1 goal in 12, 15 points. The ball with the Glen goalkeeper, Conlon Bradley. All about this kick out now. There can't be any easy plays. Glen, if they secure possession, will surely go on to win the Andy Merrigan Cup. Conlon Bradley, he's going to go long. He's going to go towards that man. Conor Glass is going to be a battle in there, and it's going to break down. It's won very, very well by Rory Fallon. Fallon able to slip it as far as the fullback. That fullback is Brian Stack, and he was fouled on the 45. He was fouled.
He was.
The Bridges have anybody to strike it from 45 yards?
Into that side, it's hard to see. Probably the last free kick was off
the
ground.
Let's give a black card to Conlon McGuckian also.
I think if you're going to give a black card at that stage, it's probably fair enough. It's a hard free with the last kick of the game. There won't be any more play. But he kicked the free previous to it, so it's going to give him a chance here.
You know a thing or two about frees in the last kick of an All-Ireland Club Final, Conlon.
Yeah, well, it's a big difference if it's a free to win it or a free to send you the extra time. This is real pressure.
So, on the 45-yard line, almost dead centre, slightly to the left, suits the right footer, which is exactly what Shane Cunanan is. Time is up at Croke Park. Cunanan has struck it. He looks to have struck it very well. He struck it very well, but he doesn't have the direction on it. It's crept to the left and wide. And that should surely be that for Watty Grahamsglen. It is that. Brendan Colley has called it up. The Maharal players rise to their feet, their supporters. They make their way onto the pitch. Malachy O'Rourke embraces his management team. Desolate, on their knees, on the floor, about 10 St Bridget players. And it's a cruel, cruel way for a game of football to end, Conlon.
It absolutely is. If you look...
Kiedla, Nuravian, Glanix, Strahus, Fagunna, Chasema, Bradley, Suez, Ogan, Far, Shaw, and Tulu, Conor Glass, Ahean, Creedley, Shale, a couple of score, Afnis, Monashin, Larry Shea, Cashmandus, Udrasak, O'Hus, Jerry, Agus Marjaler, Agus Najorek, Titchum, Ní cuireann sé iontas orm ach seo léigh na himirthe dúsa aniu. Conor Glass agus an cornagal na bhaile leis go dtí an gláin go bhaile wathartha. Tháinig sé bhaile an Astráil mar dhealar ócadí agus leithinte mar seo bhríon speisialta.
Conor Glass, co-rider, this is too late now. We're the quid AIB. Conor, All Ireland champions a year after the heartbreak. How does it feel?
Yeah. You only have to see the same. That's great behind you. Look, we definitely don't make it easy now. But this team has shown character all year, and no better way to show an Ireland final day. It's been a tough year over the last year after the Kilmacud loss, but here we're the best team in Ireland now.
You were behind leading into the break. You managed to get those couple of really, really crucial scores. You were behind heading down the home stretch and 1-3. What a response as you were coming towards the 60th minute.
Yeah, you know, we were a man down, obviously, the last 10 minutes or so. So Danny Talon and Cullen has got a massive turnover for the goal. It's those small things that maybe the crowd and other people don't see, but that's what we cherish as a teammate, and they have our backs.
Conor, in your wildest dreams when you left Australia, when you left Hawthorn, when you came back to here, could you have imagined that here you'd be man of the match in an All-Ireland final and about to walk up the head steps of the Hogan Stand?
Yeah, absolutely not. After the final whistle, me and Kieran McFaul just broke into tears. It's been a stressful 12 months, as I said, but here, we're going to cherish this moment now and lift Andy Martin Cup.
And just finally, just a word about Malachy O'Rourke and what he's done for this team and this club since he's come in.
Malachy, you know, he's a special coach, he's a special man, him and Ryan. This was never about him, this is always about the community of Glen, the community of Mahara. Malachy is here to do the job, and what a job he's done.
Well, before I let you go up to get the Andy Merrigan trophy, I have Nuala Grundaik, Harshaun AIB, Chunan Lechna, Himmer of Runnert, Kogardach is Conor.
Thank you.
And the head has gone to Sigge Conor Glass to an owner. Sinead Triukla, Le Kedekla, no sporting and loan, Le Pointe, Agson Kionale, Hawfrey to be on. Taking shit, Connison Taxon, Yenov. Agasinish, either Drapper, Shamina, or Domi, or Gonigas, nor Yernach, Colonel Lebrunner, again, Ostron, Larry McCarthy.
Togardigas. Now, like Glen, the membership got Sarwan, you August Covron, Covron, listen, Brigid, Nero and Law live, I can doubt picture of Ashenshaw, Gion Tamil. And so, ladies and gentlemen, we come to the end of two great weekends here in Croke Park, our club finals. And we are very, very grateful to AIB for their continued support of these wonderful championships. So congratulations to Tulliher, to Thomastown, to Cullyhanna, to Arba, to St. Thomas and to Glen, all champions for this year. Ladies and gentlemen, Cogardic is a reach, the Glen All-Ireland champions is a lovely ring about it, gentlemen. Cogardicus. And before I sign off, please give Brendan Cawley, our referee, and his officials a round of applause for their contribution to today's game. Gotta be Lamaha Gut Brown Dawn. It now gives me great pleasure to present the Andy Merrigan Cup to Conor Carville, captain of Glen.
Donald Malik, you're out there. Crave a hunt a few boot taking down. How crave a hair and boot in Ishaka.
And up there on the Sakar to Gale. It's more an honour day and Karn, Andy Merrigan, Aglaki, Erson, Wunchern, Glen. Ladies and gentlemen, what a day. What a journey. What a team. From winning their first county title in 2021 to winning an All-Ireland club here today, what a journey we've been on to get here. We were looked down on, told we wouldn't win a championship, and it would have been easy to give up and stop believing, but we didn't. Last year, the way things ended, it would have been easy to give up and stop believing, but we didn't. Today is a day that will be spoken about and remembered for generations to come. Today we can say, Watty Grahams are kings of Ireland! To my teammates standing here on the steps of the Hogan Stand, I can't help but to think of some of the moments we've been on to get here. This year we've had to play in rain and snow and sleet and a tornado down in that Hell 16 end today, but we've always found a way to win. We've had weddings and funerals and good days and bad days. We've a baby in the way in a few weeks. We've had injuries and fallouts and darts competitions and a Tour de France. And here we are on the steps of the Hogan Stand as All-Ireland champions. Unreal, lads. Look, I want to thank AIB for the great job they do highlighting this competition. Thanks to the staff at Croke Park. Look, the pitch is in incredible condition today. The referees, the officials, for organising and coordinating this brilliant occasion. Thank you very much. To St. Brigid's, what a game. You give it everything you got. Look, defeats are never easy. We've been there obviously last year, but I'm sure you'll have many great days to come. And if it's any consolation, I think the three teams that have been standing where you're standing the last 3 years have been standing here the next year. So a big round of applause for St. Brigid's. I want to thank our committee, led by our chairman Barry Slowey, our team sponsor Kelly's Eurospar, the both. And all the committee who handle everything in such a classy and unassuming manner. We recently ran a sponsorship programme and people came from Maharaj and beyond to sponsor and put their shoulders to the wheel for us, so thanks for everything. Thank you. On behalf of the teammates, I want to thank Johnny Bradley and Mickey McCullough for their meticulous dedication and preparing us for today. They, along with the entire backroom team of Ronan, Pierce, Steady, Orla, Gareth, Doogie and Snowy have given us incredible guidance and leadership. Thank you very much. To Ryan Porter. We're so privileged, Ryan, to have the best coach in Ireland. it wasn't an accident there that the lads were growing stronger as the game went on. We said we were going to play to the right of the final whistle. That's what we done. And I believe we're the fittest team in Ireland, thanks to you. Thanks, Ryan. Now to a very special man, Malky O'Rourke. Look, Malky, your achievements speak for themselves, but today you cement your place as a modern-day legendary manager. You're an All-Ireland champion. We can't thank you enough for what you've done for us over the past 3 years. Thank you so much. And now to the men, women, boys and girls of Glen. No matter where you go now or whatever you do in life, you stick your chest out and you tell people you're a Watty and you're an All-Ireland champion. Just want to thank everybody for all you've done for us, for the opportunities you've given us from we were wee boys walking down to that pitch, and the coaching we got, the foundation, it was all put in place. And just thank you so much for putting us here today and putting our club on the map. Thank you. And just to finish up, I think Malky was saying there's 2,200 GAA clubs in Ireland. So that's 2,200 clubs that set out at the start of the year to be in the steps here where we are today. We can say we're the best, the top of the mountain. Watty Grahams Glen, Kings of Ireland. Up the Watties!
Sha, Tresley, Mead Marshin, La Common Watty Graham on Glown, the Lanuint, Belochi, Lavi, Ballantira, Forna Elas, Dira, if we crave the Heron, Augustan Gaharu, Club, and so As Dira, oh, Tres, crave the Heron of Ochen, August David, Yenadar, Ober, Hruad, Etranona, a Honey, Connor Glass, the Tishmontas, Nahisha, Kone of Ochen Toy.
Ah, Vishina Fakon, we are embarking, Shane, in Larna Park, on Coolest Goroil, Shay, on G Halavur, in Shay, Sakidla, near Stupshig over, but on Suga on Yart Agna of Yagantlan, a Rehan Dalanshin, near Nok Roshi de Gimmergama, near Vishantin Dolomuaku, Fos Cred Shades of Frosius, Augustuka, Leshan Gul Kinunokshin, Fakvini of Breed or Asher, the Pitcher Buggin Kuddlock, but Happen Shade on Jesh, Augustin and Fog Will Shade sort of Saflahas and Ish, Augustin bring loads in Ish, Vin Law Shop.
Kakador Marshin, Vanishdor Naforna, Maliki O'Rourke, that's a Larton Ish Lamarck.
Malky O'Rourke, a club that was founded in 1948. You've only been in the last couple of years. You win a first county title. You're now on the steps of the Hogan Stand. It's the stuff of dreams.
Yeah, it is, in fairness. You know, it's happened so fast. And look, they were always a brilliant club. And to win a first county title a few years ago was brilliant. But they're an ambitious group and they just want to keep driving on. And obviously last year there's an awful lot of hurt. Hey, and it was easy saying we'll get back, but it's a long road back. And in fairness, we probably saved our worst performance at last nearly. But it was just the character of the boys. Just didn't give up, just kept plugging away and just delighted to get over the line at the end of
it. Where does that character come from, Malky?
Well, I just think it's been built up. Look at it. These boys have got serious ground over the years and underage. There's an awful lot of people taking an awful lot of credit for it. We're just delighted to come in at the end of it. And just we've built on it over the last few years and they've come through a lot of tough battles. They play for each other, they love putting on the jersey and they weren't prepared to give it up easy, and that's, I suppose, that's what happened. They end up,
we see behind us there Conor Glass lifting the Andy Merrigan trophy. Just a word about him and his impact. I know it's a squad game and all that, but he made that call to come back home and what he has done for this club and indeed for Derry. I mean, just tell me about the man.
Yeah, he's an unbelievable man. And just there today, he took the game to him on his own, and the last 10 minutes is exceptional. He's an exceptional fella, never mind a footballer. And it's great that you can do both. But he's a brilliant leader and he showed that out there today. Just a delight for him, but just a delight for all the boys, the work they put in, for all the lads in the panel, and for the club and the community. Just a brilliant day.
And that goal?
Unbelievable. Look, there's no point saying at that stage we were very worried. St. Bridges were playing well. We were struggling. We were hitting a lot of wades. We weren't really opening them up. And it was going to take something special, and that's what it was.
And while the goal was important, He actually hit 1-3 there. It was just a really solid 4 or 5 minutes coming down the home straight. And then if I could mention one, like Cahal Mulholland, he picks up that black card. But when he comes in, what a block he made. It was those little moments, as you said,
yeah,
when you
right.
add them all up.
And I suppose we've got used to that, just the boys are, have that desire, that willing to do anything to get over the line, you know. But it was, and I suppose we always target that last 10 minutes to really finish the game strong. And it looked as if, you know, we'd run out of time. But no, once we got the goal then, we powered on. The block was brilliant at one end, and then we were able to get a couple of scores. So, no, just delighted.
And just finally, what does it mean to bring the Andy Merrigan Trophy back to Mara, back to the P? Well, most of them are probably here behind me, but anyone that is left on that journey back home, it'll be special.
Yeah, look, it is exceptional. And as I said, the club have kept going through a lot of tough times, and when there was no silverware, you know, but they kept working away, and they developed the club the way it is now, and it's great for them, you know, and there'll be a massive celebration there tonight, and they deserve it. And all, look at all the players and everything. It's a brilliant day for them, and just delighted we're able to bring it up the road.
Well, Malachy O'Rourke, after the heartache of last year, we're all delighted for you here today. Very best of luck with the trip home. Enjoy it, and we'll talk to you again soon.
Thanks very much. Appreciate that.
Sean, a hunt of Rodde and Sport, Schley, Brisha Creon, the Nev Breed, Mortis, Kinnad, and Lounthra, and Ona. Hoshi, their father, Kelur, if you, Nadina, is Oigan, so Burke and Krokig. Bemidna, Rash, Trisha, Brisha, Fanny Gidding.